Well, Donald Trump has officially accepted the Republican nomination. It didn't come without controversy, though. Of course, the former president pointedly refusing to even mention Joe Biden's name throughout his speech.
Yeah, we're joined now by Victoria Cooper from the United States Study Centre. Good morning to you, Victoria. I guess, what were your main takeaways from Donald Trump's speech yesterday?
Yeah, I think it was a really interesting speech. It was the longest speech, the longest exception speech at any Republican National Convention ever or Democrat National Convention ever. I think his speech sort of had two parts. The first part was sort of this reform Trump that we were promised after the assassination attempt last weekend. He said he tore up his previous speech and now had one that was much kinder to Joe Biden. And that kind of lasted half an hour. The last 60 minutes were kind of that red meat to the Republican base, the sort of make America great again that I think a lot of us expected.
And does that unite Republicans? A lot's been made comparing Donald Trump to Joe Biden's gaffe, but does that unite his party?
Yeah, it's a really stark contrast between the Republicans and the Democrats at the moment. The Republican National Convention looked much more like the Trump National Convention in that there was such little dissension over his third now nomination as the head of the Republican Party. And to the extent that in 2016, there were Ted Cruz staged a kind of dissension. In 2020, there was still some kind of resistance. Even his rivals for the Republican primary earlier this year came out to bat for him, to fully endorse him. People that previously called him unhinged, now delivering speeches in his favour, so certainly looking united.
Can we talk about the incumbent Joe Biden, currently isolating with COVID? His family are now reportedly discussing his exit from the presidential race. He is a stubborn ox. Do you reckon he'll actually leave?
Yeah, I mean, Joe Biden ran for the presidency three times before he was successful in 2020. It's hard to know at this stage if he will leave. He has said that it would take someone convincing him that he can't beat Donald Trump for him to stand aside. He's also said that it would take a doctor saying that he's not fit enough to run again. But the polling certainly shows that both Democrats and the nation as a whole would rather see another candidate.
Yeah, he's got to go, you would have thought, doesn't he? It's just the damage has been done. But a bit of a spectacle at the Trump convention, as you describe it. Hulk Hogan, could you believe that when you saw watch
when
the shirt being
off.
Ripped off?
Yeah, it's certainly a moment I wouldn't have expected in Australian politics. It's really a stark contrast. I mean, there was a lot of wrestling themes in the Republican National Convention. He was also introduced by the CEO of the Ultimate Fighting Championship Enterprise. And I think a lot of this is just symbolism about Trump. He says he wants to fight. He says he wants to fight for the American people. And I think all of that kind of spectacle feeds into that.
What do you reckon will Joe Biden be on the ticket come November?
At this stage, it's too hard to predict, but ultimately that will be Joe Biden's decision. Only he can unlock the delegates that will make him the presidential nominee. So I guess we'll have to wait and see.
Yeah, who tells him to go? Surely someone needs to get in his ear now and go, Joe, I'm sorry.
It's a little awkward, though.
It really
hey, Mr.
is,
President,
yeah.
You've got to step down.
Exactly
like,
right. The most
who's going to do that?
Exactly.
Thank you so much for your time this
Thanks,
morning.
Victoria. Appreciate it.
Well, the assassination attempt on Donald Trump is exacerbating tensions already at boiling point in the United States on both sides of politics.
And back home, former Home Affairs Minister Karen Andrews says it is only a matter of time before an assassination attempt is made on an Australian politician. Wow, joining us to discuss that is US political scientist Professor Simon Jackman and psychologist Sandy Ray. Simon, we'll start with you. You've covered politics extensively, particularly in the US. Why is it so heated at the moment?
For a long time, United States politics has been retreating into two opposing camps. I come back to a principal fact about American politics, and that is they don't have what we have, and that is compulsory voting. You've got to get people off the couch and into the polling place, and nothing gets people motivated more than emotion, and that can be anger, it can be resentment, it can be fear, and those are the emotions that really work the best in terms of this politics in the United States at the moment. The other thing is to remember the history of the United States. This long legacy of racial tension going right back to slavery and all the way forward, the Second Civil War, I call it, in the United States in the wake of the Civil Rights era, race has never gotten off the back of the United States. You link that up with politicians willing to exploit fear and those emotional triggers in politics, and you get the politics that we have in the United States today.
OK, let's bring you back to Australia. Do you agree with Karen Andrews? Do you think that we could see an assassination attempt here on home soil?
Oh, look, you can't say never, but the one thing Australia's got going for it is the strict limitations around gun ownership. Mm. And John Howard often gets asked by American conservatives about how he, as a conservative prime minister in Australia, on the back of Port Arthur, instituted a very strict gun control regime here in Australia. I think that is a key element as to why the United States does not have a monopoly on mental illness, on people alienated and motivated to do extreme things. Australia has plenty of those people. What they don't have is easy access to firearms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's such an important point. I believe we do have Sandy now. And look, Sandy, you know, the rule is, right, we don't talk about money or politics in Australian families, but why are we getting so passionate about this?
Well, you know, politics is very polarising, isn't it? You know, what do politics represent for each of us? It represents our ideals, our values, our family values. It represents our religion. It represents so much of who we are. And of course, political psychology is understanding the political mandates that are made. It's understanding why we argue the way we do. And it understands what are the divisive issues. So this is what politics generates in each of us.
At what point, Sandy, does a robust chat around the dinner table escalate out of control?
Look, I think a robust really does, again, what politics is really representing is our values. It's representing our ideals. And why don't we talk about it so much? Because we're not very able to take on other people's opinions. When we're politically aligned, we go, this is my view, this is who I am, this is what I understand about climate change, this is what I want for education, health, this is what I want for my family. And we're often very rigid in those views. So talking around a dinner party is actually not generally the right time to sway an argument.
Simon, do you feel that tensions are building here? We've got a lot of protests, a lot of rallies happening.
There is a small fringe in Australian politics that was quite activated by COVID and lockdowns and I think felt that the state was reaching too far. But in general, I compare the Australian political consensus is far more robust than that in the United States. We believe in a public health system. There is no one in Australian politics arguing for dismantling Medicare. In the United States, Obamacare was considered the end of the world by American conservatives. The Australian debate, we agree on more than we disagree on. Still, at the end of the day, there are some voices extreme on the fringes of Australian politics, but nothing like what we see in the United States, nothing like what we see in some European countries, and critically, without the means to turn that feeling into violence through the barrel of a gun.
Well said. Simon and Sandy, thanks so much for your time today. Hey, girls, to the other big story this week, the US election, and Donald Trump is pulling out all stops in his campaign, but we've seen a more toned-down, subdued Trump this week. Some might even say perhaps measured. Emma, Hulk Hogan, Kid Rock, his megastar family, they were all rolled out. What did you make of the acceptance of his Republican presidential nominee?
I think you're right. We did see a bit more of a subdued Trump in those sort of early moments of his address. It did go for 90 minutes, it needs to be said, though. So I think we kind of started off slow. Maybe the more moderate Republicans were feeling confident that we are seeing a changed Trump. But the rhetoric kind of eventually got back to ramping up to the Trump that we know and hate or love, however you feel. I think, you know, all eyes now turn to the Democrats' National Convention next month. What's going to happen there? The Republican camp is safely, you know, locked and loaded with Trump. It's the other side of politics in the US that, you know, everyone is waiting to find out what will happen.
Amanda reports this morning that Joe Biden is speaking with his family about potentially stepping aside. Do you reckon it'll happen?
Absolutely, it has to happen. I mean, really, at the moment, they're dropping like flies. People are leaving the Democratic Party to go independent in particular. Some to the Republican, but more independent, which I actually like. I think having an independent candidate like RFK or anyone is powerful in any election. But yes, obviously, I think it's been their plan all along to have someone come in at the last minute, and I'm very curious to see who and whether that's actually going to pick up their race a little bit more.
It's got to be Kamala Harris, you would think.